Hello and welcome to Doordarshan News. With me is a very special guest today, the co-winner of the Nobel Peace Prize 2014, Kailash Satyarthi. Sir, welcome to Doordarshan News. Sir, my first question is, a very proud moment for India and the subcontinent, sir?
It's a pride moment for every Indian and for every child who is deprived of childhood on the planet. But it also means that this is a moment of more responsibility.
So did you expect this? Because in 2006, you were nominated and Grameen Bank won the Nobel Peace Prize. So this time, were you expecting?
Not really. It came as a big surprise for me. I was doing my routine work and suddenly I got the message that I won that prize. And so it was a surprise for me.
So what was your family's reaction? Elated?
Of course. It's quite common. It's obvious.
So before Friday, nobody knew you. Did you kept that low profile purposely?
Definitely. Actually, if you have a limited time, energy, resources, you have to decide where you want to invest. Whether you wanted to invest in publicity, image building, PR, or you wanted to go to the people who need you. And I tried deliberately in last 30 years that the people who need me, the parents who need me, the children who need me, may they not be coming to me, but I must go to them. So I have been working with them. Sometimes it appeared in the media, sometimes not, but I never cared. Sometimes it came as a big praise and admiration, and sometimes it came as criticism, but I don't bother. I kept on working.
So how will this prize increase or bring more into limelight the whole issue of child slavery?
Well, let me tell you that since the announcement was made 2 days ago, within 8 hours, hundreds of thousands of, rather millions and millions of people got to know about the problem of child labor and child slavery. So what, in terms of awareness, what we could have achieved during those 8 hours might have not been achieved during last 800 years or the history of the humankind. It so many media, so many social media, it has gone through everywhere in the world.
So what made you join this movement? You started your journey from your home state, Bhopal. So what made that single moment in time at which you thought that I must join this movement?
Well, there was nothing like movement before. There was nothing like this issue before. It was a non-issue. I would underline it was a non-issue. There was not a single article, single paper, single piece of line written about child labor and child servitude, child slavery. When I started using these phrases, people were stunned. Oh, they are poor children and you are calling them children in servitude or bonded child labor. Mm-hmm. So I'm happy that I have joined a movement for the cause of humanity. Mm-hmm. But I'm proud, very humbly, mm-hmm. that I was able to establish that child labor is a problem in the country and globally. Mm-hmm. So joining a movement is very easy. Mm-hmm. Creating a movement against something which is hidden but very serious problem is rather more difficult. But I always accepted challenges and difficulties.
But why this movement? Why child slavery? I mean, as you just said that before you starting the movement, there was no, it was a non-issue. But what was that moment? Why that motivation I'm talking about?
We all have been hearing that children are the future of the country. Children are the most precious gems and assets in nation, etc., etc. They are the images of God. But I could realize in my very early childhood, when I was 5 or 6 years old, when I first went to my school, I encountered with a boy of my age who was sitting at the right at the doorstep and polishing shoes for the children like me. So he and his father were cobblers. And that was the sharp contrast, which I could see that I was going to school with a lot of aspirations and hopes and you know, enthusiasm, excitement. On the other end, the child was sitting on the road as a child laborer. I don't know child labor, etc. But I saw that this is something, there's something wrong, there's something injustice. So I asked this question to my teachers, headmasters, my family. Everybody said that they are poor children and nothing is special. It's quite common. They have to work. One day I asked this to the father of the boy, and the father replied that, sir, my father started working since childhood. I started work since my childhood, and so is my son. And then he said that, you might not be knowing, sir, but we are born to work. It was a very difficult thing to digest. Why some people, why some children are born to, at the cost of their childhood, freedom, education, opportunities, future, everything. And why the people like me, the children like me when I was a child, were born with dreams and opportunities. This is intolerable. This is unacceptable.
So you're the founder of Bachpan Bachao Andolan. What is this organization all about?
It has been put on paper for last many years, but yes, for last 2-3 days, what Bachpan Bachao Andolan is doing. But it is a social movement. It's not a conventional NGO. I did not believe in conventional project running NGOs, but I believed in building social movement, mass movement, against the evil of child labor. We always believed to create a movement where we can make use of India's great constitution and the laws which are existing in the land. So we had the legal interventions, judicial interventions all over years. We also realized that there is a serious lack of corporate responsibility. So we have engaged consumers, we sensitized them and tried to build the pressure that no child must be engaged in supply chain or anywhere by the industry. We also worked with the government, sometimes to be critical, sometimes to join hands with them, to ensure that child labor has to be addressed in totality, that all children must be in school, all children, so government must spend more money on education for children and implementing schemes, etc. So it was a multifaceted approach which has been partially successful so far.
So you talked about the Indian legal system. How successful the Indian legal system has been to fight the scourge of child slavery and child abuse in the country?
I salute Indian judiciary at the top. The Supreme Court of India in particular, a number of high courts have been extremely sensitive and proactive in taking up the causes of deprived children. They have delivered very many and orders, and that was the biggest strength in our struggle.
So can you share some of your experience with Bachpan Bachao Andolan? I was searching your name, especially after Friday, on the Google. I saw some of your pictures in Google Images where there were some gruesome pictures of you with blood coming out. So you received threats also, sir?
If the blood is coming, it is the result of continuous threat. And threats culminate into attacks. So I could not recall one single year in my life without threat. So threats were always there. But who cares for threats? One day everybody has to die. I will die one day. Why should I die on court when I was 80, 90 year old, coughing, living in plain? If I die freeing children, then I would add something in my freedom movement, because I strongly believe that the freedom movement in India is not over. On 15th of August 1947, until and unless every single child, every single woman, every single man is freed from all kind of slavery, servitude, bonded labor, exploitation, abuse, fear, poverty, the struggle will be on.
So despite all these threats, what was that motivation that still made you feel that I will continue with this movement, I will fight against child abuse and child slavery?
When I was attacked, not one time, dozens of times, my people were attacked. I lost two of my colleagues, one was shot dead and one was beaten to death. Almost every activist who had been working with me in the past got injuries and scars on his or her body. Every time when you are opposed and even attacked by evil, by some vested interest, mafia, criminals, it is a proof that you are going on a right path. If I was praised by those criminals and perpetrators and mafia, then I would go to my room and look at my face on a mirror, whether I am right or wrong. And I would have definitely thought that I was wrong. So attack came as big opportunities for me.
So let's talk about the current situation of the child rights movement. What's the situation in a sense? How many children are there in this whole slavery thing in a sense? How many children are being trafficked every year in the country? I mean, what's the cause of the problem also?
Nobody knows actually. The number is very, very difficult to know. Some say 4.3 million, some say 50 million, 60 million. It's a long range of estimations because no door-to-door survey has been made. So it's hard. But if even one single child is taken away from the mother's lap, from safer environment, from school or from home, and sold and bought like animals or even in the lesser prices than animals, or if any single child is trapped into any form of forced labor, bonded labor, child labor, a girl is married at very early age because poverty or ignorance or illiteracy. If a girl is supposed to serve 8, 10, 12 people a day in a brothel, it's a black spot. It's a blot on the face of my motherland. India is a great country with great traditions, with great culture, with great ethos, with great values. And these all greatness are eclipsed by one single child. So for me, whether it's one child or 100 or 1 million or 100 million, I will keep on fighting.
So Doordarshan has a wide coverage in this country. How can our viewers get associated with your movement and with you and just fight against this child slavery, the scourge of child slavery?
One thing is the mindset. First of all, we have to change our behavior to respect our children, the children at our homes, children at our neighborhood. We should start caring and loving for the children who largely remain neglected or ignored in our neighborhood. Try to give them a little smile and try to be associated with their issues and pains. I'm not asking about doing some charity to them. I'm asking about respecting those children as well. That is the beginning. And then make sure that you are not using child labor at your homes. You are not going to accept a cup of tea or a glass of water in the homes where children are kept as domestic labor, restaurants, or anywhere. So this could be the start.
Sir, also the fact that yesterday you met with Prime Minister Narendra Modi, what transpired?
Definitely, it was very encouraging, very exciting meeting. Everybody knows, and I would reiterate that Narendra Modi is full of enthusiasm, energy, excitement. And we spoke on several issues. But one thing was very clear, that I shared my views on a child labor free India. I said that, and he agrees, that we have to make India child labor free. So child labor free India, clean India, pride India, prosperous India. These things should go hand in hand.
Sir, Prime Minister is also an avid believer in social media and the internet. How can internet, social media help against this fight of child trafficking?
So I think you should ask to the Prime Minister about
But I'm asking your views. How can internet be used?
We spoke about the impact of the social media also and the use of social media. Both of us shared this thing. And we agree that it is a very big weapon to open the eyes of the people about many, many issues and get them involved in the fight against any evil in the society. But on the other hand, the social media must not be misused. Mr. Modi very specifically mentioned this.
Sir, one of your co-winners is Malala Yousafzai. What's the similarities between your movement and Malala's movement?
She's very beautiful and I'm not. Let me begin with that. She's a young girl, 17-year-old, and I'm not. I'm 60-year-old.
But that's a similar.
so let me begin with something which is not similar, which is very easy and obvious. It's very difficult to find the similarities. Perhaps I don't see similarity because she is very famous, very glamorous, everybody knows. And I'm very ordinary, very simple, very
similarity between your movement and her movement, her fight against
the issues are similar, actually. So that's why I'm saying. I started talking on the other way because there are similarities in the issues. There are very common issues. Education, rights for girls, safe environment for education, freedom. These are very, very basic things which are common in both of us in our struggle. So that's why it is no, personality don't matter much. For me, at least, I'm not a personality cult person. So not at all. But what I feel that she and I share common values for betterment of children.
So my last question is, how can India and Pakistan together fight the scourge of this child slavery and child abuse?
I have been saying it even when Malala was not yet born. I have been working in Pakistan even 10 years before the birth of Malala, or even more, I don't know. I have been going to Pakistan since mid-80s, and I have been working there with my friends, and I tried to build a movement with the help of some concerned citizens in Pakistan. So I am a strong believer that we share common heritage, we share common history, common values, common culture, common language. Many things are common. But unfortunately, many of our evils are also common. Many of our problems are also common. Child labor is one of, we should fight together to ensure that every children in our countries are free from exploitation, is free to go to school and get the best opportunities and best quality of education. But that is not possible, let me underline, that is not possible without creating an environment of peace. And that I shared with Malala. I know Malala and her family for quite some time. I met also. We stayed together. So I spoke to her the other day and invited her, in fact, to join a new additional initiative to strengthen our ongoing campaigns, and that is peace for children. No child in Pakistan, no child in India, no child on the planet is born in an environment of conflict, wars, terror. Let them be born in peace, aman, and let them grow in peace so that they can enjoy fullest of their childhood and rights.
Malala has called Prime Minister of both the countries, Nawaz Sharif and Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Would you do the same?
I already met Narendra Modi yesterday. I'm not going to meet him today.
Sir, invite them to the Oslo ceremony.
Well, I respect her wish because I respect this young lady very much. And I wish that her wish is fulfilled.
Sir, thank you so much for speaking with Doordarshan News. So this was an exclusive chat with the Nobel Prize winner for 2014, the Peace Prize winner, Mr. Kailash Satyarthi. And hopefully after this award, this rights movement, the child rights movement will gather pace, not only in India, but across the world and of course, subcontinent. Thanks for watching. Namaskar.